Yep. Peace and reflection. Welcome back. It's Master Teacher Pierre. I am God. I am God. It's great to be observing this reality. It's great to see my reflection and, you know, my journey, my travels have been amazing so far. My piece of the all, it's like I always feel ecstatic in every situation, you know. And I've had to overcome a lot of things within myself, you know, within my psyche. I've been addressing things, you know, my whole existence is, you know, about digging deeper and figuring out how my mind works. So, you know, I just wanted to make this video. It's, you know, about addressing all of the reflections of myself, because, you know, I understand that everything is me. I am everything and everything is me. And the things that I see externally are just a symbol of me. They're just in my reality to show me something that's deep within inside myself that I believe in, you know, that's happening for me. You know, the universe is not happening to you, it's happening for you. So you have to allow, you're not supposed to resist the universe. The universe has what is coming to you. The universe is sending it, and it's trying to get you to understand pure love, you know. So with my whole childhood, it was like, you know, now I realize that, like, it was showing me so much. And, you know, I have to talk about this stuff all the time, because, you know, if you have something in your past and you choose to ignore it, then, you know, it's not going to be something that's like right in front of your face. Like, okay, this is a problem. You know, if you just ignore your issues, then, you know, you can suppress an issue, you know, here and hold it down. And then you have, it's like a ship, you know, with holes in it. You know, you try to hold this hole, you know, there's going to be pressure that's building up somewhere else. And the pressure is going to, you know, it's going to pop. It's going to show up somewhere else in your reality. So that's why it's important to keep addressing, keep, you know, you shouldn't stay silent. You know, that's what we, you know, our morals are to, you know, and this is with yourself, it's just to be authentic, you know, it's to be able to keep it real. You feel me? Our principles and our morals are supposed to come before what makes us feel comfortable. Even though feeling comfortable, maybe in the moment, it may be something that you want to do, it's not always the best thing for you to do. You know, you might want to, but it's like, you really gotta take a step back. You know, you really have to examine your situation, and, you know, you gotta just study, because you're supposed to study yourself. You know, you're supposed to be knowing yourself. You feel me? If you don't know yourself, then you're completely, you're gonna be out of the you're going to take yourself out of the race. You feel me? The race is not going to be given to the strong nor the swift, but those who endure to the end. You feel me? So, that being said, man, I had a crazy, crazy childhood. I had a crazy childhood, yeah. But it was divine. You know, it was for me to know within myself that I was whole. You know, my waking life was for me to learn as much knowledge as I needed to be able to level up. You know, it's levels, man. So many levels. And you want to be able to make it to your higher self. You know, and I'm so grateful. You know, I'm honored to be led by the Honorable Master Chief Elijah the Christ. You know, he saved my life. There's no way that I would be here. You know, I have to find ways, you know, just to repay him, because it's like the ultimate debt. Somebody saving your life is you owe them your life. It's as simple, it's as clear as that. You know, you owe them, you're in a great debt, and you know that debt is basically to myself, is to nature. Nature is at the head of that debt, and nature is wanting us to reach this state. Nature wants us to reach this state where, you know, we realize that we are it, so that we can help it be whole. You feel me? And in my life, I realized that, you know, I'm whole at the end of the day, because, you know, I came to the I am consciousness, that everything is me. I am everything. Inanimate objects, you know, living, organic, you know, moving objects, I'm everything. And it's a beautiful realization. It's a beautiful awakening. You know, so I was born, I logged in in 95 to two people that showed me certain parts of myself. You know, my Babylon parents, you know, they were guides, and you know, that got me started off with religion early. Like, religion was like real early for me. It was, you know, it was put in my face. It was pretty much slapped on me. Yo, like, I got slapped with religion. And you know, it was basically just to instill in me that there were certain principles, there were certain morals in the Bible. You know, certain stories you get out of the Bible, and it just shows you the perspective. You know, the ultimate perspective. You know, it's pretty much it's like a treasure. You feel me? The Bible is actually a treasure. It has so many jewels inside of it. And the map to the treasure is inside of my psyche. It's inside of my mind. It's showing me. What's that? Welcome to everybody that joined in the room. But you know, it's everything in the Bible is for me to unlock in myself. You feel me? So knowing, you know, the way that my parents worked, my guides, you know, they would take us to church. Like my earliest memories was not church. Like it was logging into a state of pretty much hell. Pretty much like in between purgatory and hell. You feel me? So both my guys that I logged in, my portals, they were both on crack cocaine. You feel me? So when I logged in, my Babylon mom, she was pretty much either just coming off of her addiction, or she was still intaking crack while she was pregnant with me. So when I came in, like that would be, you know, many people have underdevelopments, but if I had any type of underdevelopment, it would probably be that, like, even though I don't think that held me back from anything, like, you know, it you know, you're not supposed to let anything hold you back in this life, but knowing that, it's like, damn, you know. So, you know, both my parents were on crack. My earliest memories were pretty sexual, like, and now knowing where I'm supposed to be living from, my solar plexus and my sacral chakra, you know, it's, I understand why I went through those things. You feel me? Because I understand that's how I'm supposed to be living now. You know, I went through some things that they showed me that I shouldn't be confused about my energies. Like I was confused about my energies, and I was able to learn from that. You feel me? And that I should, you know, do what I feel. And, you know, I'm not homosexual now. Like I'm straight. I love women, but, you know, in my earliest memories, they were living in this house in Vegas. Like I was born, like I logged in Los Angeles, California, you know, UMC hospital, close to like USC in Los Angeles, California. Shortly after after I came out of the womb, I moved straight to Las Vegas. So once me and my Babylon family were in Vegas, we had a two-story house that one of my Babylon grandmothers had paid for. So we moved in there, and it was crazy because I didn't even I don't even remember, like, it's not even one of my memories, like, being taken there. You know, I didn't really start having memories until, you know, I was at the house already. And, you know, one of my earliest memories was like lighting a match. You feel me? It was like we had a house right here, and it was a house right here, and we were like in the middle, you know, there was rocks, and like we found some matches and we were like lighting matches. Like that was one of my earliest memories. Then, you know, I had another early memory. I had this Babylonian friend. It was less melanated kid. I would go over his house, and like it was like a play date kind of thing. But, you know, I started going over his house, and one of my earliest memories was ending up in the closet with him, and we were like kissing, like we'd be in the closet kissing, like, and I was like 3-4 years old. That was like a real early memory, just like getting to understand my energy. So after that, I think during this time, my Babylon parents had, you know, they were off of their addiction. You know, they had went to rehab. And then, you know, but then after that, it didn't last too long because, you know, as kids, we were outside, we were playing so much, and we would get into trouble, you know, just like any other kid. And I was there with, you know, Babylon mom, Babylon dad. They were married shortly after they divorced, and I had two older Babylon brothers and Babylon sister. And I remember waking up, and I had a crib. I was able to crawl up my crib. So I would crawl down the stairs, and like I would get like halfway down the stairs, and one of my earliest memories was like around Christmas time, was my Babylon pops like jacking off to porn. Like it was like that's one of the earliest ways that I was able to learn about sex, you know. So it was really early for me learning about like my sexuality and stuff like that. So after that, I remember being with my Babylon mom in the room. I came downstairs one day, and they were arguing, and you know, I'm in the living room, and their room is like right in front. So I came down the stairs, and then I see my Babylon dad. He was walking with the hamper, and like he walks into the room and he throws the hamper at her. You feel me? I just remember that, and it was like, damn, you know, like that was that like as a child, like being like four, made me kind of, you know, I was like, damn, you know, it's fucked up. So I ran up to her and I was like, damn, you know, I gave her a hug and shit. So after that, my Babylon mom, they got divorced, and she took my Babylon half sister and they moved back to California. And I think she was still an addict, so I think she just kept, you know, she didn't want to quit. And my Babylon pops was like, he was able to not, you know, be kept by doing crack. Like he was able to stop real quick. And so after that, you know, we experienced a lot of we experienced a lot of moving around. But at the same time, like that taught me that taught me about myself. Like that just showed me, like now looking back at it, like man, I came in with some issues because my Babylon parents, they were just versions of me. Like they were past versions of me, past selves. You know, I'm here now. I'm here to transcend what they were doing. I'm here to you know, start a new path. Like this is the righteous path. So I'm like, I'm breaking a cycle here. I'm breaking a curse that I was in my past lives. You feel me? That's how it is for me. So I remember like one of my biggest things was like I didn't have too many friends. Like I was known. Like I would be in school and I'd be like, I would have friends, but I wasn't like super popular. Like people would know me, but I was always by myself. Two, every year to a half a year, like I would be at a different school. There was no time there that I don't remember not being like the new kid. You know, I didn't know anybody for more than a year, and then I would have new people around me. Bananas. Like I know a lot of people, you know, not really deep relationships, but you know, I would have like an expansive, like a lot of people knew me. So it was bananas, because you know, after that, me and my two Babylon brothers, we stayed with my pops. We moved into a small apartment, and And it was just like me and my Babylon brothers, like we would always like we were always fight, like we were cool, but then like we would always fight, and then we would, you know, we'd be cool, and then like we would get into mischief and we would play together, but then we would fight. And this happened for a while until my Babylon pops couldn't even, he wouldn't be able to take care of us. You know, and the same thing with my Babylon mom, she would be, we'd be cool, and then she wouldn't be able to take care of us. So the first time we moved back to Cali with my Babylon, moms, and you know, I was in like kindergarten, and yeah, it was kindergarten, or no, that was preschool, and we lived basically in my Babylon grandmother's house, and that's the first time I experienced death too. Like we went to a funeral, and I was like, it's the first time I seen a dead body. It was weird. Like we went to a funeral of my of one of my uncles, and it was like weird, like just seeing it, like, and I knew what a dead, it's crazy that I was at such a young age, I knew what a dead body looked like. It's that's bananas. Be like dang, like that's crazy, yo. Like having that, you know, being like four or five years old, 6 years old, and you already know what a dead body is, like what it looks like, you know. I don't know. I have it because I'm a Pisces. I'm a Pisces sun, Pisces moon. So I have a lot of experience. You know, it's like I've been here already. You know, I've been here. I'm kind of over it. So it's like I already know what everything is. I'm in tune. Like I'm in tune with like with life. You feel me? Yeah. But I should have been on. Anyway, so, you know, after that, you know, Babylon mom, she would get back to doing drugs, and I would move back with my pops. Then, you know, something would happen where he would always have an issue, like he would always complain. He would always show us about like what his bills were at, you know, where you know, he wouldn't be able to pay for a certain thing, you know. He wouldn't be able to get us things. It's like we experience poverty, but at the same time, we weren't poor, but like we weren't too well off either. You feel me? Like we were just getting by. So, you know, then then my mom, like they would always marry, you know, I would always have like a stepmom or Babylon stepfather, you feel me? And you know, the first time I experienced that was when I was getting into the fourth and fifth grade, and we had these Babylon friends, and I was like, oh, before that, we moved back to, like when I was around 7 or 8, we moved back to Las Vegas with my Babylon dad, and he was so, he, like, I was born in music, like my whole life was like doing music. You know, my Babylon pops was always, he was always a professional musician. He always had like a band. So he met a family friend at the time, and I basically consider them like my cousins and uncles and things while we were living in Vegas. And so the first time we went to their house, they had a son, and the son, he looked like a girl. So like the first time we met him, it was like, damn, you know, is this your daughter? And they were like, nah, that's a boy, you know, that's Dominic. His name was Dominic. So, you know, and this was my friend from like, he was like, he was like four, and I was like, he was four, and I was like five, and I knew him till I was like 19, you know. So I knew him for a pretty long while. He was like one of my, like, the people that was closest to me, you know, throughout my life. But you know, we would be at their house a lot. And I remember we would always be in the room. They would be in the garage because it was like a garage bin, you know, and they would always let us just be in the room. We could, you know, we could chill, we could play video games, we could eat. They always had food for us. You know, we could talk to each other, we could do whatever, man. But we decided to play house. So we were figuring out our sexuality, and I didn't even know that this kid was like what he knew. Like, he was younger than me. He was a year younger than me, but he knew, like, it's like he had trauma that he had went through, situations that he had went through that he knew about sex. And it was like, I didn't even know about these things. Like, I still didn't know about sexuality. You feel me? I wasn't taught about sexuality. And that is a huge problem. That's the whole, all of everybody in Babylon, like, sexuality does not get taught correctly to children in Babylon. We send our kids to institutionalize. They program them with GMO food, and they just get sent home, you know. And while the parent is out slaving all day for shelter and peanuts, basically, you know. And the more money you make, the bigger shelter you can have. But at the end of the day, you know, you're in it, being in Babylon, you're working for the government, basically. You're working for the bank, you feel me? And the bank is nothing more than evil. It's the evil, you feel me? Like, it's ridiculous. But I just remember, you know, hanging out with these people, and this kid, like, we would go there like every weekend, man, every Wednesday. And we would also, the same band that they had, the same garage band, they did like jazz and blues and R&B music. And that same band was like the church band, like, that we went to. So that's how deep we knew each other. They were just like all our own band. It was like, it was all ran by my uncle, the family friend, you feel me? So when they would take us over there, we would just be chilling in the room, and all of a sudden, you know, it was just me there one of the times. And we started going into the closet. You know, we could even sleep there. We were there so much. I think actually my Babylon brothers had fell asleep, and we had went to the closet. Me and this Dominic, we went to the closet, and we did the same thing. We kissed. I don't know if I, like, we were grabbing each other's penis, and, you know, I might have, you know, put his penis in my mouth. I don't know if I was, like, able to, but, like, we were, like, kissing and stuff. So it was like he was putting his mouth on my penis. You know, I was putting my mouth on his, and he was like, it's, I guess that's what happened. Like, it's happened. So, you know, I didn't know anything about sex, but I guess he did. But it nothing really would happen from it. But it was just like, you know, it got to the point where it happened so often, like 2 or 3 weeks, where it would just be going on. And my two Babylon brothers that were older than me, you know, I think I was like 5 or 6. And I mean, the other one was 8 and the other one was 10. You feel me? So we're 2 years apart. So they ended up joining in on it. You feel me? And then, you know, they would move to different addresses. You know, the band leaders, like my uncle, they would move. So the next house that they moved to, the same thing would end up happening. You feel me? So it was like a weird time for me, and you know, we would have to move. Like we would get like kicked out of like whatever apartment we were living in, because my Babylon pops would like lose his job or whatever. And you know, so this next house that they lived in, you know, we were like going deeper. Like we were like, you know, pulling down our pants, like me and my brothers and this kid, and like we were like bending over, and like they would be looking at each other's butts and stuff, and we would still be in the closet like kissing or doing whatever, you know, just exploring our sexuality. Like it wasn't even, you know, it's not even something that should be looked at as like a really evil thing. It's like it was like pure. It was like, you know, we didn't know what any of that stuff was. You know, my orientation now is, you know, I'm straight. I'm heterosexual. You know, I love women. You know, I can't get turned on by a man. You feel me? Like, it's not possible. like, shit, I go limp. But, one of these times that we came over, this cousin, the family friend, he told me this time, like, yo, you know, I'm gonna go get my little sister. You know, he had a little sister, and he would basically, like, he took her into the bathroom. It was just this one time. He said, I'm gonna take you to the bathroom, we're gonna do what we do, you know. So he took her to the bathroom, he came back in the room and got me. He was like, come on. So I went with him to the bathroom, and you know, I was like 7 at the time, and you know, he was 6 and she was 4. Feel me? So yeah, so so in that moment, he told me, like, yo, you know, pull down your pants, you know. He told her before you know, anything happened. He was like, yo, if you don't tell anybody, I'll give you money. We'll pay you. Just don't say anything. You know, don't say anything to my pops. And you know, she looked scared. Yo. Like she didn't know what was going on. You know, being 4. And he told me, like, yo, pull down your pants. So I pulled down my pants. He pulled down his pants. And at that moment, his little sister, she basically, like, she started to reach for my penis, like, and in that moment, like, I came to all clarity. Like, I was just like, I realized it was wrong, and I just like pulled away. I pulled away from her. I zipped up my pants and I ran out. Like I ran out to the other room. And, you know, like I said, I don't know what he did afterwards, but I went back to the room. He came back in and it was just like a weird moment. Like, because, you know, at that moment, we just, you know, after that, we just went home and, you know, nothing happened for a while. You know, it was just like nothing happened. And then like 2 or 3 weeks later, you know, we were in church and church was about to end. And, church was about to end. And my Babylon pops pulls me into the back room and he's back there with their dad. You feel me? With my uncle, you know, the family friend. And he basically figured it out. She had said something to him. And, you know, they just, you know, questioned me like, yo, like, you know, what was going on? What happened? And I was just like, I was just telling him like, yo, I told him the story, like, yo, we went into the room, you know, cause I ain't never been no snitch, man. Like, I've never been a snitch, bro. So we went into the room. I told him like, yo, we went to the bathroom. She was, you know, we were about to do whatever we were about to do to her. You know, we're about to hump or whatever. And I pulled up my pants, like I pulled away right before she was about to, and I ran. And then they were just like, huh, you know, and they were just like, all right. And I guess they tried to just like, you know, all right. They were just like, yo, we're just going to get over this, you know. So, you know, it was really like nothing had happened, bro. And then, you know, everything was cool for like a few months, you know, like 4 months, 3 or 4 months. And all of a sudden, like it was, cause it was around, it was the holidays. It was like around Christmas time, a few days before Christmas or whatever. And again, my Babylon Pops was like, you know, he wasn't able to take care of the financials again. And, you know, he was losing his job. He was losing the apartment. And, you know, we came in one day. We were doing something after school. And my Babylon brothers picked me up. And, you know, at this time, like, I'm like 8 now. And all of a sudden, you know, we get home. And it's like later, it's like 7 and it's like dark out. We walk in and my Babylon Pops is sitting there and we can tell like he was pissed. Like, so all of a sudden, we were in there and he figured out basically everything that had happened, you know, that all of us boys were in the room, you know, we were like kissing and like, we were, you know, we were experiencing sexuality with each other. You feel me? So basically, you know, he was pissed at my older two brothers, and when it came to me, he was like, yo, come with me, you know. So we went on this drive, you feel me, and he took me to this office, and basically, when I got to the office, this lady came up to the door and she opened the door and she was a detective. Like she was a fed. So, you know, I basically put it all together in my head. I'm like 8 at the time. So I figured out, you know, what was going on. So she took me to the back room and she was like, I'm asking you some questions. Do you want your dad in the room with you? And I was like, nah, like, no. So basically, she asked me a series of questions. Like, she asked me my side of the story, and I told her, like, yo, she asked me, you know, did you touch the girl or anything? And I told him, like, nah, he went and got her. He told her that we would pay her money. And when he took me into the bathroom, he told me to pull down my pants. And, you know, he told her to suck our penises. And, you know, when she reached for my penis, I pulled away and I zipped up my pants and I ran out the bathroom. And then, you know, nothing happened after that. And so I gave her, and she asked me like a series of questions. Like, she just asked me, like, yo, had me like point to different places. Like, did you touch you there? Did you touch her there? I was like, no. So, you know, after I got done with that whole interview, it was like that basically this kid, he had blamed the whole thing on me. Like, he said that, you know, it was my fault. You know, I told them to do it. It was my idea. And I was like, whoa, what the hell? So I was more cognizant then. And now that I'm realizing it, like, my Babylon Pop, like, I'm pissed, bro, because it's like, you don't own your child. You feel me? The government owns your kids at a certain point. And when it comes to a certain point, when a certain thing happens in life, it's like, if you're in that system, full control gets taken away from you. You feel me? Switch little keys. Full control. You feel me? You lose all rights to what you think is your child. You have no right at a certain point. You feel me? It becomes a government issue or system issue. Like, so after that, my Babylon Pops, he ended up losing his job. He lost the apartment for all of us. You feel me? So we had to, again, you know, my Babylon mom, she came up like, yo, like, you know, I'm clean. I've been clean. But went to rehab. I'm getting she had married this dude that was like 70, you know, he's like stepfather. So she not married him, but she got with him. So she was like, okay, you guys can come live with me in California. Hold up. So there we go again. Then we move, you know, I'm going into the fifth grade. And, so after we move, back, and we ended up, we were in this neighborhood where it was like the neighborhood. It was like Harlem 30 Crips, and it was like King and Normandy. So on this neighborhood, we had made some friends, you know, and over, you know, the next few years, they were like some of our like best friends. You feel me? Like, they ended up being like godbrothers to us. But and that was like the first experience that I had smoking weed too. I mean, weed was like a big part of my life. You feel me? It was like a lot. It was like a lot, man. But the situation that had happened had resurfaced when I was going to school there. You know, I figured out that I had a court date. You know, we figured out that they were pressing charges. The state was pressing charges against me for molestation. So I remember going back. I had to take a flight back to Las Vegas for the court date. And I remember getting back there and my Babylon Pops picking me up. He was still homeless. So we were just riding around for like a day or two, and you know, we got me some food, and you know, we were sleeping in the car. He was staying with a friend, you know, some nights. And man, my Babylon Pops, he was like 45 at the time, like 45, 50 already. and I'm only like 10 years old. I'm like 9, 10, and then we do the hearing. We get to the hearing, and the judge comes out. You know, we wait for a second, we go in, the judge comes out, and it was a real quiet process, and it was crazy because the same judge that had judged my case, judged my Babylon Brothers case like a few years ago, and he had got like some time in prison. Yeah, he had got some time in prison, and that same judge, I don't know if he had recognized me or not, but, you know, it was a crazy time, man. Crazy, crazy childhood. But I just sat there, you know, I sat there in court for like 30 minutes, and then the judge came and he looked at me, he was like, you know what you did wrong, right? Like, he looked at the paperwork and he's like, your kid, you know, doesn't really look like you did anything too much wrong. And, you know, he was like, you would know not to do that again, right? And I was like, yeah, that was the universe right there. Like, cause he basically dropped the charges. And I just had to do like a therapy. Like I had to do like 2 months of like mental therapy just to make sure that, you know, I wasn't like a weird kid, I guess, or whatever. So I did a session when I was in Vegas, and you know, I actually knew the lady. She was like in my Babylon Pop. She was in his band, in the same band. Like, she was a singer. So I did a session with her. And then I moved back out to Cali, and I was like in the fifth grade. So I finished up the sessions there, and I didn't have to deal with that anymore. It was like the universe like took me out of like, I knew it was like a level up after that, like 10, you know, like the state came for me. The government came for me, bro. Like, they came to get me, and I'm just glad the universe, you know, was able to help me level up off of that. That was amazing. Now, also in the fifth grade, that's when I figured out I was not a gangster, bro. Because I lived in Cali. So, you know, coming up, we had friends that made us feel like we were in a gang. Because, like, their dad was in the gang. So it was like they were, like, really hood kids. And we lived right across the street from them. So we would always go over, we'd be hanging out, and we'd be chilling. Their dad sold weed and stuff, and he ran a tow truck, you know, out of their house, and he was like really known gangster in the neighborhood. And also the kid next door to us, we started hanging out with them later, and we would all be smoking weed and stuff. But that was the first time I had smoked weed, when I was like 10. Like, right before I moved back to Vegas, we smoked weed. But I remember going to the school, and the kids there, like, I would hang out with them. But since I was, like, a new kid, like, I wouldn't hang out with anybody too much, but they knew me. And we would walk home together sometimes. And basically, like, I thought I was, like, a hood kid. Like, we were starting cliques. The kids right next door, we would start cliques, and we would hang out. We were like junior mafia, stuff like that. Like, we would like try and be gangsters, man. And so I was walking home with these kids one day, and it was like this Mexican gang that was in the neighborhood, and they were called 18th Street. So I was like, I'm really rebellious. I'm a wild person. So I like kicked the sign. Like, I was like, you know, fuck that hood, you know. So the kid that was with me, he was scared. He was like, don't do that, you know, blah, blah, blah. You know, my friend is from this gang. And he ended up telling the kid that I did that. The kid was like in eighth grade. He was like 13. And I was like 10. You feel me? I was like 9, 10. So I figured out that the kid wanted to fight me because I did that. And, you know, this is when I figured out I was not a gangster, bro, because I was in school and I was, like, scared to fight this kid. Like, I felt like if I would have fought, I would have won because I was bigger than the other kid. He was, like, a little Mexican. He was like a Hispanic kid. But I did not know how to fight. I didn't know how to fight. So it was, like, I never really got into a fight. You know, but this kid was coming for my neck. So one day I was getting out of school and I was like walking down the street and the kid just came, like he just came out of nowhere. He was like, "Yo, you know, you talking about my hood? We got scrap." So, you know, I was like, "Man, I don't know how to fight." I was standing there with my backpack, like, "Man, dang, what am I gonna do?" So the kid was like taking off all his jewelry and stuff. He took off his shirt and he was just boom, like he started coming at me. And you know, I wanted to do something, but I didn't know how to fight, bro, like at all. So the kid like swung at me and I dodged the first time. He missed and then he swung again. He hit me like right here. And this is the moment I knew that I was not a gangster, bro. Like I was not a gangster at all. He hit me and I was like, wow. He just hit me and it kind of hurt. Like I was like, dang, I just got hit, bro. Like, didn't hurt that much. I had like a little tiny bruise, but it was like, man, I got hit and it hurt, bro. Like, I rationalized in my head and I just ran. Like, I ran all the way home, bro. Like, I was like, man, I'm gonna go get my big brothers. It was ridiculous. But anyways, man. So. Yeah, man, I'm not a gangster. Like, I wouldn't even try and be a gangster. So, after that, I would see the same kid. Like, he was just act normal and shit. Like, whatever, like, regular. And I remember the same school. Like, I turned the wrong corner at the school, and I got lost, yo. And I walked. Like, I walked for like 3 hours, bro. Like. I walked for like 3 hours straight and I ended up like hella far away from my house. And this guy came and I was like near the freeway. This guy came and he picked me up and he drove me all the way back home. I was like, it's an angel, dog. He was an angel. He dropped me off. Babylon Mom was pissed, but at the same time, like, I was not tripping. Like, I was dope because anything could have happened. But it was divine. It's for a divine purpose. Like, I've been realizing that my universe is like, it has me get off through like situations really easily. My universe. But yeah, the universe has some things set off for me. It's like beautiful, beautiful things. But you know, after that, you know, my Babylon mom's like she didn't really take, you know, she had diabetes and high blood pressure and she was bipolar. She had bipolar disorder. Like, she would trip out on this. And that's when my Babylon brothers, they started getting in trouble. And one had one started going to juvie. And it was crazy because, like, my whole life, I realized that I'm here to learn from other people's situations because a wise man learns from other people's situations. You know, a smart person learns from their own issues and their own situations and gets over them. But a wise man, you know, learns from other people. And so I don't have to go through the same things because I'll learn from a mistake that I didn't even make yet. So I won't have to make it. You feel me? So that's what my life has mostly been like. So, you know, I seen my older Babylon brother make a lot of mistakes and, you know, join actually like, trying to be a gangster and like going to juvie for it, you know, and now he's doing like 10 years in prison. You feel me? And the other one is homeless because he was just really rebellious. He thought he was a gangster, figured out he wasn't, started doing drugs, and now he's like homeless, trying to get through life. You feel me? So, you know, with that, it's like, after that, I remember going through so many different schools. Like, every year was a different school, bro. Like I was going into middle school, and I remember moving back with my Babylon pops again, and we would get robbed so much. Like, we still lived in the hood, you know, nicer place, but it was like he moved into this place just off of like, he just moved in desperate, you know, he was desperate to just get us back and, like, you know, have us chilling with him again. So, you know, we lived in a cool place, but we would get robbed a lot. Like, it was still the hood. It was like Donna Crips or something like that. And we would always, my life was mostly like having fun and like hanging out with friends, like, and then drugs started getting involved, and we would smoke weed a lot. Like, so the first place that we had moved to was like a trailer park. And you know, I witnessed, like, really starting to smoke weed, and, you know, we would drink beer, and my Babylon pops, he had married this lady with dreads, and you know, I would have friends come over, and they were doing meth, you know, and they would be like tripping out in the house. And, like, we didn't do those drugs or anything. It was just like I'm witnessing, you know, like, and the same kids would, like, rob us. Like, we would get robbed, bro, so much. Like, we would get stuff, and then all of a sudden it would just be gone, you know, like. So after we moved out of there, we moved to this place where it was like two stories, but we would always throw parties. Like, we would always have friends over. We were always smoking weed, and we would have, like, parties. Like, we would just throw parties. Like, my Babylon pops, he wouldn't be there, like, for, like, the whole night until early morning, so we cleaned up before he got there. But it just got to a point where our friends were always over, and, like, he would show up, and we were just all in there just, like, chilling, like, 20 of us, and he's just like, oh, okay. He just goes upstairs, and, you know, he's, like, chill. Like, my pops was, my Babylon pops, he was cool, like, but, you know, for me, you know, it was just weird, like, seeing everything happen. My Babylon brother selling coke, and, you know, the whole SWAT team would come, and they would, like, you know, he would get arrested, and, you know, we see him, like, we would come out, and we see him on the wall, like, hands zip tied behind his back and shit. Like, so for me, you know, I was good. Like, I was a good kid, but I was like, fuck the system. You feel me? Like, I was always like doing what it took to be like, oh, you know, my family's going to have a good life. I'm going to take care of them. But I realized, you know, now, like, it was just for them to realize, it was just for them to be like, you know, we don't really have to do anything with our lives, because he's going to be successful. They would always tell me that, yo, you're going to be successful. Like, you're going to be a millionaire. And, you know, I was like this golden child. You feel me? It was because I was smart. And, you know, my life pushed me to be smart. But I would realize I was using my knowledge and my intellectualism for the wrong reasons, yo. But so after a while, like, I didn't like where I was living, you know. I was like 15, just starting high school at this point. I got out of middle school. I remember in middle school, like, once, like, there was this girl that I would walk home with, and I really liked her and stuff, but I realized, like, she wasn't really, like, feeling me like that. Like, she wasn't really digging me, but we would always hang out. Like, she was kind of digging me, but I don't know, girls have always treated me like they was digging me, but, you know, they just didn't want to, you know, they didn't want to do anything. So that was cool. That was cool. Like, I'm not, you know, to my universe, I'm whole. You know, I'm whole with myself, you feel me? So, but I just remember being at this park one night, and, like, I would hang out with the dudes, and, you know, she liked the dude, like, some of the dudes, like, all, you know, all the dudes like her, but it's like, she liked some of them, So they basically, like, we were in the park, and they, like, ran the train on her, like, while we're all in the park. And, you know, it got to a point where, you know, like, one dude was, like, kissing on her shit, and it was, like, two dudes kissing on her. And then it was, like four dudes, like, holding her down and shit, like all, like kissing on her shit, like, trying to hit and shit. And, you know, it was weird that, like, I was there to witness that, like, I'm hanging out with them and shit. And even in that moment, like, I liked her, so it was like, damn, you know, like, she was beautiful. Like, she was, to, like, physically, she was beautiful, yo. Like, to be in the eighth grade, it was ridiculous. So, like, in that moment, like, while she was being held down, like, I had touched her vagina. Like, I touched it. And it was weird that she didn't say anything to anybody else. When I did that, like, everybody was holding her down and shit, and I did that, she was like, yo, and, like, she knew it was me and shit. Like, she was mad weird. Like I don't know, that was just a weird situation in my life, you know. But I realized after that, like, yo, like, these niggas is tripping. Like, they're really, like, it was wrong. Like, it's so wrong, bro. Like, I look back on this situation, and it's like, yo, that's one of the times I realized, like, these chicks, like, thoughts, man. Like, they, especially being in Babylon, if they're gonna be in the system, they're gonna try and make it, bro. Like, and they don't really care about us, you feel me? They care about, you know, what they can get for themselves, you know, sensory pleasures. You know, everybody's in Babylon looking for sensory pleasures, man. And that's one of the things I realized, it wasn't gonna work for me, especially being a Pisces sun, Pisces moon. I'm like, over it, bro. Like, I've been through this before. I'm not about to get in no trouble, you know. I'm doing my bed, and I'm about to here, you feel me? I'm headed back to the sun. I'm headed back to the sun. I'm going to join the flame of life. Let's get out of here. But, yeah, so after that, 4 more years in high school, every year I was at a different school. And, you know, some of that time I got, you know, we were still smoking weed. And my Babylon pops, he got kicked out of his house again. He wasn't able to pay any, like, rent, and we ended up moving back to Cali. So this time we moved back. The friend, we were still in that same house, bro. Like, we were still in that same house, and the our friends that were living next door, we seen them grow up. Like coming back there, like, we seen them grow up. Like, I didn't think I was going back there, but we seen them grow up, and, like, they were, you know, they were getting older. The one that I hung out with the most, he ended up being in juvie. Like, he started getting in trouble. He joined the 30s. He joined the Crips, so he started going to juvie. You know, and, you know, I would still hang out with them, but it was like, you know, I'm just trying to get my education straight and make it for myself, for my family, so, you know, I can have all the money and shit. And that was like, that was high school for me. Like I remember, like, but I, at the same time, I remember ditching, like, so much. Like I ditched, like, 10th grade, 9th grade, 10th grade. I ditched for, like, it was like 50 days in a row. And what we would do, like, we would leave the house and we'd go right around the corner. And I had a Babylon girlfriend. Like, we would just go to her house, and we would smoke weed the whole time we were there, and we would just drink, smoke weed and drink, like, 4 Locos. And it was, like, it was crazy, man. Like, we would just drink and smoke. And, you know, after a while, you know, my Babylon mom, she started breaking down again. Like, she would have, like, nervous breakdowns and stuff. And she ended up marrying, like, actually marrying the dude that was, like, 70. He was, like, stressing her out and shit. But Yeah, my bowel movements crazy, bro. But I was ditching so much, and I ended up coming home one day, and she had found my report card. Like, I had grabbed the report card, the one that came in the mail, I threw it away. So the one I had, it was still in my pocket. So when I got home, like, she was washing my clothes, and she was folding them, she was drying my clothes or whatever. She found the report card, and it showed that, you know, it was a progress report. You know, at the end of the semester, I still got all, you know, I got all A's and stuff or whatever, but I had failed that whole semester. You feel me? So she seen it, and she was like, nah, y'all gotta go. She was like, and she had the nervous breakdown. Like, she was bipolar, so she would get angry, but she had this paddle, and it was leather. And it had a big metal rod down the middle of it. And it was like one of those pads that you would use for, like, beating blankets or something, like beating all the dust out. And she had one of those, and she would whoop us with that shit, like, hard, like, bow, bow. Like, I remember my Babylon mom, she would be, like, drunk. Like, she would be an alcoholic. My Babylon pops is, like, an alcoholic. And they would whoop the shit out. So it got to a point where she wasn't able to do that to me anymore. Like, I remember, she was, I, she would do it when we were like 10, 9, 10, and we would get in trouble, and she would just hit us a few times, like 4 or 5 times with it, boom, boom. And I remember one time, like, I got in trouble. She whipped me with an extension cord. It was crazy because she had left. My Babylon brothers had, like, locked me out of the house. And I was, like, in my boxers. And it was, like, super cold outside. And she pulled up. And she was like, why the fuck you outside? You're not supposed to be outside. And she got an extension cord. Light me up, bro. And then another time, I remember, I was on the bed. And, like, she had this broom. She was, like, whooping me with it. And she, like, broke it over my back, bro. And then it was like a 3-story house, you feel me? So we would clean so much. Like that's why I know my universe, you know, my son in the 6th house, everything is coming through work. You feel me? Like, I work. Like, I get it. But I remember cleaning, like, whole house, toothbrush, like, cleaning the walls with, like, a brush, small brush. I remember cleaning the floors with, like, a small brush. Like, they would make us clean the whole house, 3 stories. You feel me? But the man that she married, like, he was a hoarder. You feel me? So we'd be cleaning around a bunch of junk, you know. So it got to a point where she would break down. But I didn't even scroll down. But yeah. But wow. Yeah, I didn't even see that. Wow. Yeah. Hey, insulators, you gotta go, bro. Gotta go. Gotta go. Yo, any insulators in the room, you will be blocked. Feel me? Go watch something that you agree with. All right. But but yeah, anyways, man, like, why she tripping? Why shawty tripping? Tripped up. But yeah, so, you know, after that, me and my Babylon brothers, like, we started splitting up. Like, one went to juvie, one ended up just, like he would stay in Vegas, and I would go to Cali, and I had to go to school there. And after that, you know, I moved back to Vegas, And I was finishing out my last two years of high school, and you know, that's where things started getting like a little more tough for me. Like, you know, I didn't really have the support, and I was like, man, how thinking about how am I going to be successful? How am I going to make it? Seeing where I'm at, you feel me? So I would play basketball. Like, I thought I was pretty good at basketball, and I did music. So, you know, I was like, man, either way. So, tried out. I was pretty good at basketball. I just didn't go through with it. Like, it wasn't something that was appealing to me. You feel me? Like, at a certain point, like, I was like, man, I'm not that athletic. You know, we weren't, like, our parents didn't make us do anything athletic. So I was like, man, I can't start playing basketball, you know, in the 11th grade and actually, like, get somewhere, you feel me, not being athletic. But so I ended up just, like, focusing on music, focusing on getting into college, you feel me. So the last year, it was the same thing in 11th grade too. Like we would have friends over, like, all the time. We would smoke weed, same thing. And then my 12th grade year, we moved, like, we're figuring out that, you know, once again, my Babylon Pops, he didn't have the ability to provide for me. Like, he didn't, like, he was just like, he was pretty much like giving up on us. You know, the place that we were at, it was like, that's the other thing about the tropics. You know, like, you'll see that living in, you know, your natural environment, there's way less like roaches. Like we would live in apartments in Babylon that had so many roaches, dog. Like, so the place that we lived at, like, it would just be infested, bro. Like, it was ridiculous. And even that place, like, it was cheap, but he couldn't afford it anymore. So we were about to get kicked out again. He lost his job and shit. But at that moment, he had found another girlfriend. So we were able to, I was able to finish out the 11th grade, and then we moved to Northern Vegas, and we moved in with his girlfriend. And they were like, you know, I finished my last year of high school, you know, I was able to get into college, but they were like, man, to stay here, you know, you're gonna have to get a job, and then pay you, you're gonna have to give us like $200 a month or whatever. So I was staying with them, everything was cool. And that's where I had got my first Babylon girlfriend. You feel me? That's where I lost my virginity and everything. But it was crazy because, like, her Babylon children, like, they would come and they would stay with her. So it was like a bunch of us in the house. It was like almost like a shelter. Like it was like keeping us in the shelter, and nobody's really being successful, you feel me. I was just in this place, and I was about to start going to college and stuff, and everybody had issues. Nobody could pay the bills. My Babylon Pops still couldn't keep a job, you feel me. And this is all just, again, it's just showing me, like, it was just showing me, you know, what I had to come up from, you feel me. So I started going to college, and to get to college, I started going to UNLV. It was in Vegas. And to get there, I would have to take two buses there and back. So it was like, it took like 2 hours to get there, 2 hours to get home from there. And I picked up like five classes. Like, so after two semesters, I flunked out after two semesters. And I was still working, but it was like, man, you know, this girl that you're with is distracting you. It's like, bro, they were like, you got to go. you know, I was like the only one, I was the only one that was super like trying to be successful there, but it was like, yo, you know, we're going to keep all the people that aren't doing anything with their life. And, you know, you should move. Like, so I moved with my Babylon brother, you know, and it was cool because he did music. You know, he's a rapper, and, you know, he was living in Cali, so I moved back to Cali, you know. But at the same time, it was just, yo, staying with him. It was, like, working, you know, so I worked until I was, like, 20. I was, like, just working. I'm, like, 21, 22, and I'm just, like, working. But I was going back to college then and working. So it was pretty cool for a minute. And then, you know, I started watching the Honorable Master Chief Elijah Christ. And I started trying to figure out how to, before I started watching him, I was trying to figure out ways to just improve my overall life. Like I went through this dude and he was like doing calisthenics and, you know, he was working out a lot. So I started working out. And I was thinking about just different ways that I could be successful. And I started watching like the Ralph Waters, Dr. Sebi, and I was just trying to figure out how can I be more wealthy, man. And then like I seen one of Chief's videos one day and I'd skipped over it and I was just like, man, I'm still vibing high, you know. I had went vegetarian, vegan, and you know, I was just working. You know, my Babylon brother, he was vegetarian, so he was trying to go hard, you know, but he was so caught up in his life. You know, he had a wife and he was trying to take care of certain things. He had, you know, he had Babylon kids and he couldn't, you know, well, he's working on certain things, you know, within himself. But it's like, you know, I seen where he was at compared to where I was at. You know, I was like, I didn't go in as much in life. I didn't get myself into as much things. But even in this place, like I realized like they were still smoking weed. And once I figured out everything about weed, I could not smoke anymore, man. Like I couldn't. But so I started going to music school. So I got in music school, you know, be a producer, and I ended up doing well in that. Like I just ended up graduating from there. But like I was so like, you know, after I found the Honorable Master Chief, I did not fuck with the system. Like bro, like anything that had to do, like I wanted to get out so bad that I didn't really care like what it took. I didn't really care. Let me delete this last comment. Like I was just like, man, let me get out this. Let me stop fucking with it. Like I started experiencing like the water was like fucking me up. Like it was terrible, bro. Like I was smoking so much weed that it was just like I couldn't really breathe anymore. It just seemed like every breath that I was taking was just to take a puff of weed, you feel me? And I knew that it couldn't be conducive at all. Couldn't be conducive for my life, you feel me? I smoked so much weed. It was like, I was just smoking it just to smoke, man. I hated it. I started to hate it, bro. And, yeah, I couldn't really deal with it. So, but then I got blessed, man. Like, I realized that the universe was, you know, taking me, you know, on a certain course. And at the end, man, I was just like, you know, I was like, how do I get to the tropics so much? And you know, I started feeling blessed, more and more blessed. Every single day, like I would wake up, I would get a download. And every time that I got a download from the Honorable Master Chief Elijah, like every time he did a download, it made me more and more hype. Like I got way more hype, bro. Like, it pumped me up. Like I would be like it wasn't even anger. It was just vigor. Like I would just feel extremely strong, you know, like every time he did a video, every time he dropped something, you know, every time they dropped some music, it was just like, yes, let's get it. We're on the right path. And that's, you know, that's for anybody to take with you. Like, if you watch these videos, if you really watch Carbonation, you start from the beginning and you just watch every video, take your time out, do your due diligence, study, then you'll realize it's like, man, this is really rewarding. This is really self-gratifying. You know, it's ridiculous. It's really divine, but like, people downplay it like, oh, this is this guy, this person here, and he's just a guy, and they can't see him as God. But everything is God, bro. Like, we know everything is God. Everything is God. I am God. You know, you are God. Anything, any situation that you're in is not too large for you to overcome. You know, you can do anything. You know, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. You feel me? But yeah, that was, you know, when I got to the tropics, I started to realize, like, man, I'm untouchable. You feel me?
Master Teacher Price and Master Teacher Pure to the pool area. Master Teacher Price and Master Teacher Pure to the pool area.
So yeah, man.
1 second, I'm up in the storage with Master Teacher Program getting some for him. Well, he's getting something. I'll be down there in a minute.
I think Pure is still alive.
Yeah, I'll be down there in a minute.
So yeah, man, it's been a beautiful, beautiful day. You feel me? We out here in the tropics, bro. The kingdom of heaven, you know, the kingdom of God is just a place where you commune to have everlasting life. If you can vibrate to the frequency high enough to understand all of this knowledge, then you will be in constant communion with God. God is energy. Life is sex. And every experience that you have is teaching you this. It's teaching you that everything is everything, yo. You feel me? There's nothing outside of you. You feel me? You're living in your body as a fractal version of itself. And everything that you see is you testing you, just to see if you can vibrate higher to the next experience. This is a proving ground. You're supposed to prove to yourself who you are. Feel me? But with that being said, I love my self-reflection. It's gonna be up on YouTube. Master Teacher Pure TV on YouTube. I love myself.